In previous lessons, we've talked about kinetic energy and work. And in this lesson, we're going to learn how kinetic energy and work are related to each other. In particular, we're going to talk about what's called the work energy theorem, which is an important law in physics, which tells us that the total work or the net work done on an object has to equal that object's change in kinetic energy, where capital delta means change, and change in kinetic energy, that would be an object's final kinetic energy minus its initial kinetic energy. So this work energy theorem allows us another way to solve problems besides Newton's laws and kinematics. For example, let's say we have a book that is, say, 2 meters high, and it has a mass of 3 kilograms. Okay, well, if I drop this book and gravity does work on it by exerting a force on it over the distance of 2 meters, and the book falls down and hits the ground, then we can ask, what's the speed of the book right before it hits the ground? Now, you know how to solve this problem from previous chapters using the kinematic equations. But we could also solve it using the work energy theorem. We could say that the work done on the book by the force of gravity equals the book's change in kinetic energy. So let's see how that would work. Well, the work done on the book by gravity would be equal to the force on the book due to gravity times the displacement of the book times cosine theta. The force of gravity on a 3 kilogram book is mg, so that would be 3 kilograms times 9.8 meters per second squared. The displacement of the book is 2 meters, and since the displacement and gravity are both in the same direction, theta is equal to 0 and the cosine theta term is equal to 1. So that's the amount of work that gravity does on this book. 3 times 2 is 6, times another 9.8. That's 58.8 joules. The work done by gravity on this book is 58.8 joules. Now, according to the work energy theorem, if the work done by gravity is also equal to the total work, in other words, if there are no other forces that are acting on the book, then that work also has to equal the book's change in kinetic energy. And there are no other forces doing work on the book during its fall. So we know that this 58.8 joules has to equal the book's change in kinetic energy. In other words, 58.8 joules, the total work done on the book, equals the book's final kinetic energy minus the book's initial kinetic energy. Well, its initial kinetic energy is 0 because we're dropping the book from rest. and the final kinetic energy must equal 1/2 times the mass of the book times the final kinetic energy squared. That means that I can solve for Vf, the speed of the book, right before it hits. So we have, then you need to multiply both sides by 2. We also need to divide both sides by the mass of the book, which is 3 kilograms. And that is equal to the final velocity of the book squared. If I want just the final velocity of the book, then I need to take the square root of both sides. So that gives us the square root of 39.2. And the square root of 39.2 is 6.26 meters per second. So, of course, we could have found this same information by using the kinematic equations, but the work energy theorem gives us an alternative way of solving the same problem, and there will be times when the work energy theorem is more convenient than using the kinematic equations. Okay, let's do another example. Let's find the work that must be done by friction to slow a car of 500 kilograms moving at 50 miles per hour. To a stop. Okay, now in a previous example, we found the kinetic energy of this car. We first showed that 50 miles an hour is equal to approximately 22 meters per second. You can go back and watch that other lesson if you need to. So the work done by friction, if using the work energy theorem, the work has to equal the car's change in kinetic energy. So the work, in this case, is the car's final kinetic energy minus the car's initial kinetic energy. Well, in this case, the car's final kinetic energy is zero because I want my car to stop. So the work that your brakes have to do in order to stop your car, if it weighs 500 kilograms and is going 22 meters per second, would just be equal to the initial kinetic energy of the car. That would be minus 1/2 the mass of the car times the speed of the car squared. That work then is equal to about 1.2 times 10 to the fifth joules. So that's how much work the brakes of your car have to do in order to stop the car if it's 500 kilograms moving at 22 meters per second. the negative sign simply means that the kinetic energy went down. Okay, that's a little bit different than saying that the energy is negative or that we were doing negative work. The negative sign here indicates that the car's kinetic energy was reduced. It does not indicate direction. In fact, both work and kinetic energy are scalars, which means they don't have a direction. So you will never need to resolve, for example, you never need to resolve either work or kinetic energy into X and Y components because it doesn't have X and Y components. It is a scalar. That is one of the things that makes the work energy theorem helpful is, you know, if you can solve a problem using scalar quantities instead of vector quantities, usually the scalar way of doing it is going to be easier because you don't have components to worry about. Okay, let me give you check your understanding question. And this also serves as one of our proportionality questions that show up on exams every once in a while. Okay. So, if you're driving in your car and you double your speed from, let's say, 30 miles an hour to 60 miles per hour, how does your stopping distance change? By stopping distance, I mean how far is your car going to go between the time that you slam on the brakes and the time that you come to a complete stop. Okay. So, do you think that it will take you that your car will travel twice as far? Your stopping distance will double if you double your speed. Perhaps your stopping distance will quadruple. Maybe your stopping distance will stay the same. And maybe you think it will be something between A and B. So pause, think about this for a moment, come up with your own answer, and then unpause, and I'll tell you what the correct answer is. All right, are you ready for the answer? The correct answer is B. It will quadruple. We need to look at the work energy theorem in order to arrive at this conclusion. Big surprise, right? This is a check your understanding problem on the work energy theorem lesson, so it stands to reason that the work energy theorem would have something to do with the answer, doesn't it? So, if the work done by your brakes is equal to your car's change in kinetic energy, what happens if I double my speed? Well, 1/2 mv squared. So first of all, if I double my speed, because speed is squared in the kinetic energy equation, that means your kinetic energy will quadruple. Your kinetic energy goes up by a factor of 4 when you increase your speed from 30 to 60 miles an hour. All right, what does that have to do with work? Well, if I increase my kinetic energy by a factor of 4, I also increase the amount of work that my brakes have to do by a factor of 4. And work is equal to force times displacement times cosine theta. Well, the angle doesn't change just because I double my speed. And the force that my brakes are able to apply doesn't change just because I've doubled my speed. My brakes are the same that they always were. So if I'm going to increase the work by a factor of 4, the only way to do that is to increase my stopping distance by a factor of 4 So it quadruples. That is answer B. And that's the end of this lesson. In future lessons, we will learn about other types of energy besides kinetic.